Hello everyone. Today we are going to learn about urine analysis for abnormal constituents of urine. Urine analysis is very important in evaluating overall metabolic and kidney functions as well as diagnosis of many metabolic and systemic diseases. It is a routine investigation in clinical practice. For first year MBBS students, urine analysis and urine report is very important topic. In practical examination, the question B is urine report, which carries 15 marks. Urine analysis in biochemistry includes two important heads. First is physical examination of urine and second is chemical examination of urine. Physical examination includes the physical properties like volume, color, appearance, odor, pH, specific gravity and total solids. While chemical examination includes the chemical tests for detection of various abnormal constituents of urine, for example, glucose, ketone bodies, protein, blood, bile salts, and bile pigments. I have divided this topic in two separate videos. In the first video, we are going to discuss about physical examination of urine, and second part will be on the chemical examination. At the end of this session, a phase 1 MBBS student shall be able to mention physical properties of the given urine sample along with the observations and explain the significance of physical properties of urine. Urine is the excretory product formed by the kidney and it is ultrafiltrate, carrying the waste and toxic substances from blood. Urine formation involves three major steps: glomerular filtration, reabsorption and secretion, and these three processes ensure only waste and excess water is removed from the body. The first is glomerular filtration. In this, the filtration membrane allows water and small solutes to pass but blocks blood cells and large proteins. Second is reabsorption. In the glomerular filtration, what happens? The glomerular filtrate contains water and waste but also contains some useful substances like glucose, amino acid and smaller protein. So these needed substances and some water are reabsorbed through the tube walls into the adjacent peritubular capillaries, and this is called reabsorption. The third is secretion. In this process, some waste ions and hydrogen ions, they pass from the peritubular capillaries back into the renal tubules, and these secreted ions combine with the remaining filtrate and form urine, and it is then excreted. This is how urine is formed. Urine analysis requires urine sample. Let's see how the urine samples are collected. First is midstream morning urine sample, in which patient is advised to discard initial part of the first voided urine in the morning after getting up, and then to collect 15 to 20 ml of midstream urine flow in clean glass or plastic container. This sample should be analyzed within 2 hours, and if it cannot be analyzed, then it should be refrigerated. This sample is commonly used for routine urine analysis. Second type of sample is random sample. It is collected on the spot at any time of the day. It has limited utility and is generally used for detection of glucose, ketone bodies and proteins. The third is 24-hour urine sample. The sample is collected for 24 hours from the time of discarding first morning sample. A preservative is used while collecting the sample, and it is commonly used for quantitative estimations like creatinine, protein, calcium, etc. So what type of preservatives are used for during collection of urine sample? The preservatives are hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid, toluene, thymol, acetic acid, and the use of these preservatives depends on the analyte that needs to be analyzed in a urine sample. Let's begin with the first part of urine analysis, that is physical examination of urine. As I have said, it is the first part of routine urine analysis. It is done by direct observation and it gives hint for the subsequent urine analysis. The various physical properties are volume, color, appearance, odor, pH, specific gravity and total solids. And in front of these physical properties, you should mention the observations. The first physical property is volume. In the undergraduate practical laboratory, volume will be provided to you, and if it is not provided, you should measure the volume with the help of measuring cylinder, and you should be able to explain the significance of volume. The normal volume of urine, the urine excreted daily, is 800 ml to 1800 ml per day. What is polyuria? If urine excretion is more than 2 liters per day, it is called as polyuria. If it is less than 400 ml per day, it is called as oliguria. And the third condition is anuria, means cessation of urine output. The urine excretion is blocked. So you should be aware of three important terminologies. What is mean by polyuria, oliguria, anuria, and their causes. What are the causes of polyuria when there is increased excretion of urine? So it occurs in conditions like diabetes mellitus, diabetes insipidus, which is due to deficiency of antidiuretic hormone, and in when diuretics are given to the patient, it can result into polyuria. What are the causes of oliguria? In conditions of diarrhea, vomiting, there is loss of fluid, in shock, or in case of fever, whenever patient takes or person takes less fluid in that condition, or in the conditions of renal diseases like acute glomerulonephritis. These conditions can result into oliguria, which means there is urine output is less than 400 ml per day. The third is anuria. Anuria occurs in the conditions of bilateral obstruction of ureter, shock, mercury poisoning, or incompatible blood transfusion. Second important physical property is color. By looking at the color, we get the hint of various clinical conditions. The normal urine color is pale yellow, that is straw colored to yellow, and it is because of urochrome or urobilin. Urine can be pale to colorless in conditions like if the person is having large fluid intake, or if he is suffering from diabetes mellitus or diabetes insipidus. Urine can be dark yellow to brown red in case of dehydration, fever, or if the person is on certain medications. Urine is yellow brown to beer brown if bilirubin is present in the urine in conditions of jaundice. It is clear red in case of hemolysis or hemoglobinuria. It is cloudy red in condition of hematuria, that is presence of RBC in the urine. If urine contains porphyrins, melanin, homogentisic acid. Homogentisic acid is excreted in conditions like alkaptonuria. Milky white urine can be seen if fat, cystine crystals, WBCs and phosphates are present in the urine. Red color of urine can be due to if the person has consumed beet, or if he is on the antitubercular drug like rifampicin. Bright yellow color of urine can be due to the B complex vitamins. Rusty yellow color can be due to the sulfonamides. So we should have the idea about the diet the person is having and the medications that person is taking. Third important physical property is appearance of the urine. The normal appearance is urine is clear and transparent. It becomes turbid if it has pus cells in case of urinary tract infection, if there is presence of leukocytes, epithelial cells, nitrites, phosphates, chyle in case of filariasis. So all these conditions give rise to turbidity to the urine sample. Urine becomes cloudy if it is concentrated in conditions of urinary tract infection. If urates, phosphates, uric acid are present in the urine, it gives cloudy appearance to the urine. Fourth physical property is odor. Normal urine odor is aromatic, though it is subjective. On standing, the odor becomes ammoniacal due to decomposition of urea into ammonia. Fruity odor is seen in diabetic ketoacidosis. Mousy odor in phenylketonuria. Cabbage odor in tyrosinemia, burnt sugar odor in maple syrup urine disease, and foul smell odor in bacterial infections. Fifth important physical property is pH. In the UG practical laboratory, litmus paper is provided, and you should dip that litmus paper in the urine sample, and depending upon the result, you have to write whether it is acidic or alkaline. The normal urine pH is 4.8 to 7.5, the mean is 6. On standing, urine becomes alkaline because of formation of ammonia from bacterial decomposition of urea. Acidic urine is excreted in conditions like fever, metabolic acidosis, that is due to diabetes mellitus, starvation. Alkaline urine is excreted in conditions like metabolic alkalosis, for example, in vomiting, cases of vomiting, if alkali therapy is given to patients, and in case of urinary tract infections. Sixth physical property is specific gravity. Specific gravity is the density of urine divided by density of water. It is directly proportional to the concentration of solutes excreted in the urine. The normal specific gravity ranges from 1.010 to 1.025. Specific gravity is increased in conditions of diabetes mellitus because of presence of or excretion of glucose in urine, in condition of nephritis, that is proteinuria, presence of protein in the urine makes the specific gravity more. If there is excessive perspiration, the urine is more concentrated, and that's why the specific gravity is more. The specific gravity is decreased in case of diabetes insipidus because the urine is diluted due to deficiency of antidiuretic hormone, and whenever there is excess water intake, the urine is diluted, and that's why the specific gravity is decreased. The seventh important property is total solids. Total solids in gram per liter is equal to last two digits of specific gravity multiplied by 2.66, that is Long's coefficient. The important question is how to measure the specific gravity of urine. So let's understand this. Specific gravity is measured with the help of the instrument called as urinometer. This is schematic representation of urinometer, and this is a bulb which is present at the bottom of this urinometer. It has some fixed amount of mercury, and on the neck it has some markings. What does this markings indicate? The markings ranges from 0 to 60. The marking 0 indicates the specific gravity of 1, 10 indicates specific gravity of 1.010, 20 is 1.020, 30 1.030, 40 1.040, 50 1.050, 60 is 1.060. And between these two markings, 0 to 10, 10 to 20, again this is divided into 5 equal parts. So for example, between 1 to 1.010, how it is divided into 5 equal parts? So the first part will be 1.002, second 1.004, third 1.006, fourth is 1.008, and the fifth is 1.010. So when this urinometer is dipped in the urine sample in this measuring cylinder, then the lower meniscus of this urine sample corresponds to certain marking on this upper stem of urinometer, and that's how the level at which it corresponds to this marking specific gravity. And this urinometer is calibrated at 20 degrees centigrade, so we have to do that certain temperature corrections according to the room temperature. To measure the specific gravity, take urine sample in the measuring cylinder and suspend the urinometer in the measuring cylinder containing urine sample. You will see the lower meniscus of urine sample corresponds to 20, that is 1.020 specific gravity. And it is called as observed specific gravity. It is 1.020. Now, as the instrument is calibrated at 20 degree centigrade and the room temperature is different from that, so we need to make certain temperature corrections. The corrected specific gravity is equal to observed specific gravity plus temperature correction. So it is written as 1.020 plus in bracket 0.001 multiplied by temperature difference divided by 3. It means that for every 3 degree rise, you have to add 0.001, and for every 3 degree decrease, you have to subtract 0.001. So the urinometer is calibrated at 20 degree centigrade. The room temperature given is 38 degree centigrade. So the temperature difference is 18. By putting the value in the formula, it becomes corrected specific gravity is equal to 1.020 plus in bracket 0.001 multiplied by 18 divided by 3. So we get the specific gravity of 1.026. In this video, we have studied the first part of urine analysis, that is physical examination of urine. In the second part of urine analysis, we will study about chemical examination of urine.